Good evening once again. My name is Dr. Jonathan Wallace. I am a senior lecturer in the School of Humanities in the field of classics, which means that in my day job I teach and research Roman literature and Latin, by which I mean the language and not the dancing. On behalf of the University of Tasmania, I'd like to warmly welcome you all to our Island of Ideas public talk series, and in particular to tonight's talk, Melodies as Medicine, the Power of Music, which is brought to us by an exciting collaboration between the University of Tasmania and Hobart's very own and very wonderful Festival of Voices. The Island of Ideas series connects Tasmania's community and research to people across our regions and into a global network of ideas and emerging issues. These conversations are an important part of the university's role. Connection, collegiality, and community date back to our founding and have been core to our university's values since our founding in 1890. As we launch into a discussion on music and on its impacts on wellness, we reflect on the deep history and culture of this island. The University of Tasmania wishes to acknowledge the Muwinina people and the Palawa people. They are the original and traditional custodians of the land on which our campuses are built in Lutruwita, Tasmania. We pay our respects to elders past, present, and emerging, and to those who did not make elder status. The Aboriginal people have made music together here long before 1788. The Muwinina would have gathered in Nipaluna, Hobart, beneath our mountain, Kunanyi, to share stories, knowledge, and cultural traditions. Singing and dance remain important cultural practices for today's Tasmanian Aboriginal community. So as we discuss this topic tonight, we reflect on and acknowledge their deep history of caring for land, and particularly their storytelling and knowledge-sharing traditions. Such practices have strong connections to the past heritage of the Aboriginal people, but also celebrate the new styles and emerging talents of contemporary artists, one of whom we'll meet again later tonight. One of the things we want to do this evening is involve you experientially in the mood-changing abilities that music provides. So at 2 points in the evening, I'm going to invite you to record how you're feeling right now. So, I invite you to take out those phones and scan the QR code on the screen in front of you. Doing so should, fingers crossed, lead you to a one-question survey where you can share with us how you're feeling in this particular moment. Now, this input is invaluable as we investigate the impact of music over the course of the evening. One final reflection from me before we get underway. As I mentioned earlier, I'm a lecturer here at the University of Tasmania, and part of my role, therefore, this evening is to represent the university as a co-host of tonight's event. But also, for many years, I've been involved with choirs and various choral communities. And in that context, I've also got considerable experiential engagement with the topics we're talking about this evening. Now, I'm very aware that this is not an experience unique to me. I'm sure that there are many, many people here this evening who have similar experiences of the power of music. I'm talking particularly about the power of music to shift our mood, to make us feel, hopefully, better. One little anecdote from me, I'm the conductor of a choir here in Hobart, the Allegri Ensemble. Our rehearsals are on Wednesdays. Wednesdays, hump day. Particularly as we head into winter and the clock ticks towards 7 p.m. on a Wednesday evening, generally a nagging thought will cross my mind saying something like, I kind of wouldn't mind just collapsing onto the couch with a glass of red rather than heading out to choir practice. But 2 hours later, I'm always thoroughly glad that I did. And by that, I mean go to choir practice, not full onto the couch. And possibly my choir is also glad because, after all, I am their director. I think that if that's an experience that any of you share or have heard about, then I think tonight's going to be absolutely fascinating as we find out more about why this is. Why do our moods change in this way? What happens in our brains to bring about this uplift of the spirits? But alongside the fascinating is also the important. Research in this area, led by figures such as those who will speak to us this evening, is already creating important developments in the way that in medical treatments for both physical and mental health. So tonight will prove to be a fascinating, very interesting experience, but it's also evidence of the vital research that's going on and leading to benefits or improvements in our communal well-being. Enough from me. It's now my pleasure to introduce the Nourish Women's Choir, a group of passionate and diverse women who come together to celebrate the joy of music. This group of community choristers operates under the skilled guidance of director Betsy Hansen. Betsy actually directs two community choirs and several projects involving group singing within the community. She works in the Department of Education, Children and Young People Re-Engagement Program as a trauma-informed music specialist and is passionate about dismantling barriers and creating greater access to creativity, both for individuals and for groups. Now tonight, Nourish will treat us to two songs that reflect their unity, inclusivity, and most importantly, I think, their love of music. Please, again, welcome Betsy and the Nourish Women's Choir.
Thank you, everybody. Welcome. We're going to sing two songs for you tonight. Our first song is called Iggy's Lullaby, and it's a beautiful lullaby written in Noongar language by Gina Williams and Guy Gauss. They are from Western Australia. Gina Williams, I saw it several years ago at Signet Folk Festival. Absolutely fell in love. She's the most extraordinary woman. I asked her if I could do an arrangement of this song. Her response was crying and saying, yes, please. And we've had this beautiful friendship ever since. That's just over years. We finally got to sing it together at Rosny Barn with the choir this year, which was really special. And our second song is Fix You by Coldplay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. don't succeed. When you get what you want, but not what you need. When you feel so tired, but you can't sleep. Stuck in reverse. Love someone, but it goes.
Well, wasn't that absolutely marvellous? Betsy, you have a fantastic group. Nourish, that was awesome. Thank you so much. Watching the group come together as one, that was powerful. It had me smiling and tapping my toes. And it was great, over and above the music, to see the way that the singers in the choir began smiling and swaying together in communal enjoyment of the music. It was absolutely fantastic. Just wonderful. All right, now we've had some music, and it's now time to start talking about music and the impact it can have on our well-being, on our bodies, on our psyches. Now, to bring that about, I'm going to introduce two colleagues of mine to share their thoughts and their research on the intersection between the arts and well-being. First, we'll hear from Associate Professor Anne-Marie Forbes. Anne-Marie is an accomplished performer and musicologist who studies the powerful impact of the creative arts on mental and physical well-being. Anne-Marie is a dedicated educator and led the development of a new interdisciplinary area, creative arts and health, with associated teaching programs and research projects based here in the School of Creative Arts and Media. Anne-Marie's achievements and advocacy in this field have been recognised internationally, and she was elected as a Fellow of the Royal Society of Public Health in 2020. After Anne-Marie's presentation, we'll welcome Associate Professor Alison Canty. Alison is a neuroscientist with a long-standing interest in the plasticity of neural circuitry in the brain, particularly through the process of ageing and in neurodegenerative disease, including dementia. Alison is one of the associate directors of our Wicking Dementia Research and Education Centre, and she's also an Atlantic Fellow for Equity in Brain Health with the Global Brain Health Institute at Trinity College in Dublin. Please join with me in offering a warm welcome to Alison and, first of all, Anne-Marie.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here this evening and to have the opportunity to talk to you. I think all of us here recognise the power that music has to hold us, to embrace us, and to reach deep into our souls. The reason it can do that is somewhat miraculous, but it explains why music is at the very heart of our being, and why it has such an immense potential to change lives and to affect us both physically and mentally. And we can harness that capacity in order to improve health and well-being for everybody, for everybody. Music is at the very heart of our being. It's been part of human civilization from the very beginning. And we know this because there are artefacts that can date back over 50,000 years ago, from the early days of our human ancestors. We have evidence that they were making flutes from bones and instruments from mammoth tusks. That's really hard to say. So song and music making are at the very heart of our being. It's a sort of primitive thing. It probably predated speech. Singing and making noises that were toned probably was the precursor to speech. And we know that our early ancestors had the ability from their musculature, from the ways in which their skulls are shaped. We know where the muscles attached. We know that they had the capacity for song. So we were able to know that this was very much a part of the most ancient humans on the planet. And music and dance continue to play a very important role in their communities as a gathering point, a way of bringing the community together to celebrate and to reinforce that community identity. it's a really important part of the way we also use music as a way of representing identity, whether it's teenagers with their teenage tunes that they love so much, or whether it's church music, or whether it's dance music, music that belongs to a particular culture. All of those things bring communities together. One of the earliest ways in which we engage with music is as a baby. And that very early engagement with music is really important for brain development. Singing lullabies to your baby, and it's in some cases a lost art, singing lullabies to your baby actually helps the baby's brain develop. Not just in their appreciation for music, which is a bonus, true, but in all sorts of other ways, because it builds that bond between the mother and the child, or the parent and the child. That singing is a kind of shared experience. It gives a focus for the child, so that visual focus is also an important part of it. Where mothers are singing, they've done studies, where mothers sing lullabies to their children, they recognise that there's better bonding between mother and child, that there is less crying from the infant compared to those babies where there are not lullabies being sung. They wake less at night. Oh, that is a bonus. That's the best reason ever for singing lullabies to your child. And they experience less colic. Again, another really good reason. If you look at preterm infants, the ones for whom the developmental challenges are the biggest, their engagement with their parent or caregiver singing to them, as distinct from music that might be in the background, actually they show lower stress levels and higher oxygen saturation, which again is really important for their brain development. So it's a really important thing to do. For the mothers, it also has a big plus because they feel closer to their infants. It's been used as an intervention for postnatal depression, and it's been seen that where mothers are singing to their babies as part of a program, and even having to be taught how to sing to their babies because it's not something that's come to them from their grandparents, in many cases that tradition has been lost. So they have to learn songs to sing to their baby. They learn how to adapt songs they like to sing to their baby. And that can then increase that bond that they have with their child, and it also helps their own depression and lifts that cloud for them. It reinforces that they're caring for their child, that closeness. Of course, when children get a little bit bigger, we see all sorts of things occurring. And you will have heard, no doubt, about the Mozart effect, that if you play music to your baby, they will be more intelligent. I'm sorry to disappoint you. It doesn't quite work like that. They may have slightly better spatial organisation, and it doesn't matter if it's Mozart. but the point is that the engagement with music when the brain is developing, especially in that first 1,000 days of life, can give a child an advantage, and it can help to address disadvantage, which is a really important point. So those first 1,000 days of life are absolutely critical for setting up a child's health and well-being for the rest of their adult life. So they get a little older, the opportunity is there to learn an instrument. And I've been involved in a research project with the Tasmanian Youth Orchestra, where we were looking at the ways in which a youth orchestra and participating in that could affect well-being for the players. They all told us that being involved and playing in the orchestra made them feel better. It was the highlight of their week. but also that they were learning skills that were coping skills. They were learning skills that would give them what we would describe as resilience. So they could cope with disappointment. They learned how to deal with things going wrong in performance, because let's face it, they always do. And they found that they learned from their conductors, who modelled the behaviours of saying, it happens, we'll move on. They learnt that it was okay to make mistakes. And that's a really, really important skill. We find that social development, mixing, they find in often in orchestras or choirs, they find their tribe. And that's a really important part of growing up. They also improve their memory. So whether it's playing pieces of music from memory, learning the words of songs, all of those stress the memory and really expand it. Motor function, if you're playing an instrument, obviously. Fine motor skills and coordination, again, really important. It's one of the reasons why children who have difficulty with their coordination, for whatever reason, often benefit from learning a musical instrument, because it balances out left and right hands. So particularly the piano, where left and right hand are doing much the same thing. But the harp works just as well. There's all sorts of things that they can do. And dance, of course, as the adjunct to that. It's also been shown that learning a musical instrument can affect your performance in other subject areas, particularly in areas where symbols are used. And by that, I mean music is like language, is like mathematics. And that's the reason that all of those three tend to cluster together. They all use symbols to represent things. And so that use of symbols in music primes the brain for using symbols in other things. And that's why it has that effect. And the effects of learning an instrument are lifelong. If you learn an instrument up to the age of 10, even if you were absolutely no good at it, that will in fact affect your brain. It protects, according to what the research is showing us, it protects against age-related decline. So it's a good thing to do, and it's never too late. So learning an instrument, even in your 50s, 60s, 70s, will still have a protective effect. So get out those flutes and violins right now. One of the ways in which music is being put into use to promote health and well-being is through what we call music therapy. Now, music therapy has been around, if you like, certainly in the Bible. David played the harp to King Saul because of his upset spirit, obviously some sort of, you know, mental illness, and he played the harp to soothe him. That's music therapy in a sense. And it's harnessing that power of music. So it's been known about for a very, very long time. As a modern profession, it really came into play in the early part of the 20th century, after the First World War, as a treatment for soldiers who returned from the war with what we called shell shock, or we now know as PTSD. Accredited music therapists work in all sorts of places, in hospitals, in the community, in schools, and with people in prison, and in various marginalised communities. What they're addressing in many cases is mental well-being. They may be addressing things such as clinical disease. They may be trying to deal with children who have developed mental disorders, or children with autism. And one of the really interesting things that they use for children with autism is what they call improvisatory music practice. So that consists of the therapist with perhaps on the piano or with a drum, and the child likewise has a xylophone or a drum, and they have a conversation, which is non-verbal conversation that goes from one instrument to the next. This teaches this call and response technique, very, very ancient, if you like, but for children who are non-verbal, it's actually a way of communicating, and they've found that by using this process, children will often start to verbalise, they'll start to sing, and when they start to sing, then they'll start to speak words. So it's an amazing transformation that you can see, and children with autism are often very attracted to music, so you can use that power as a way of helping them to develop the other skills they need. And it also develops their social skills. So it's a marvellous intervention. Singing, as we've been hearing tonight, singing has all manner of benefits. So we know that singing, whether you're singing by yourself under the shower or you're singing with a choir, you see an increase in emotional well-being. You feel better. And that's to do with all those hormones that are flooding around the brain that just lift your mood. We know that it's a very good way for people with mental health problems to increase their well-being. It makes them feel better, it brightens their mood, but it also brings them into contact with other people. So when they come and sing in a choir, as a program that I'm very familiar with in Norfolk in England, in that they have these groups that they set up for people who were living with mental illness in the community. People were invited to come along. In fact, their doctors recommended that they go. And they went along and sang, discovered they felt better, they met other people, and when they thought that they were going to have 10 or 20 people, they suddenly discovered they needed a bigger hall because they had 80. It was meeting a real community need, and people recognised the benefits. For people with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, what we used to know as emphysema, it's been shown that singing can help improve the way that they feel and also improve their breath control. I've done a program, looking at the way in which music and singing can affect breath control. It also can decrease your pain level. If you're busily engrossed in singing, you don't notice your pain at that point. And that's, again, because of the hormones that are flooding around. Those natural endorphins that are released when we're singing and having a great time and feeling better, we also don't feel the pain. So there's a potential there for music in pain relief. We've found that even for people undergoing cancer treatment, it can reduce nausea, it can reduce pain levels. And it also increases their immunity. So they're less likely to get all the other bugs that are flying around as the result of their treatment. And we know that singing in a group promotes a feeling of closeness or community with those around us. Even if you're singing in a pub choir with 2,000 people on a hot, sweaty night in Brisbane and you don't know the person next to you from Adam, people still report that they feel close to that person, they do anything for them. And they've never met them before. That's a way of changing the world. Music can also have an incredible effect for people with dementia. Yes, it can improve their mood and their sense of well-being, and if singing songs can be a way of strengthening memory and recall, particularly you're remembering a melody, and often the melody is the one that's easy to remember, the words are a little more challenging. Try and remember the words without the melody. Yeah. See, the two are really closely linked in our brains. We remember the words of a song with its melody. Just trying to remember the lyrics is really hard. This gives us a key as to what happens. For people with dementia who can still sing songs, although they may have great difficulty recalling what happened earlier that day. But they can sing songs that they learnt when they were younger. They can learn new songs. It's been well shown now that it's not a case of, oh, you can only use songs that people knew. No, it's not true. You can teach new songs. I had the experience of working with a group in Canterbury in the UK, teaching a song to this group, and I was given the song by the group leader and said, here, you teach them this. It was a round in Latin. I said, really? And they said, oh yeah, it'll be fine. So they did it. It all worked just fine. And I followed up with them and said, okay, so what happened the next week? And she said, oh, well, the next week it was if they'd not seen it before for the first time through, and then they were fine. And 3 weeks down the track, they could sing that round as though it was something that they'd always been able to sing. Just goes to show. We underestimate the power of music. For older people, it can improve posture, it can improve breathing, it can strengthen the throat, so those swallowing difficulties that people may have as they age, they can be treated through singing, strengthening those muscles. For people with dementia, music making, singing can help reduce agitation. And that's one of the big problems for people who are carers, people with dementia, is the way in which you settle them. Even in advanced dementia, you can find that music will trigger memories and may even awaken the person. So somebody who is unresponsive may suddenly start singing. I was involved in a project in Deloraine where we were working with people with dementia measuring respiratory function. And we tried all the standard equipment for measuring respiratory function. I think you can imagine what it looked like, very scary. Including elasticised bands that we were putting around them. And they took it all in good fun, which was fantastic. But we didn't get good measures. What we did get good measures from, however, were kazoos. We used kazoos to measure respiratory function because you could get somebody to buzz into a kazoo and it was a load of fun. You could sing your songs through a kazoo and it didn't matter if you couldn't remember the words, it was fine. And you could also buzz through your kazoo, and the length of your buzz and the steadiness of your buzz was, in fact, an indication of your breath control. And they loved this, so they practiced. So over 8 weeks, we saw incredible improvement, up 50%. In one case, up 150%. Extraordinary. And of course, as they were doing their little test, we did it in the public room where everybody could watch. And so they were all gathered around and they were clapping and cheering people to keep buzzing, keep going, go, go, go. It was so exciting. So it became a real community event. We also find that there are a number of therapeutic uses of music which are changing the way in which therapy is delivered for people who've had stroke. first of all, doing your exercises after you've had a stroke or any kind of major surgery is never fun. You need a bit of an incentive, and music is a great incentive. So if you're playing music and moving to the music, it's much easier to do your exercises. It's also a very important treatment in aphasia, that is the loss of the ability to speak after stroke. Interestingly, the singing pathway, if you like, and the speech pathway aren't quite the same. And by using the singing pathway and using a sing-song intonation and singing the words you want to speak, often people can sing the words they want to say, but they can't say them. So they sing them to say them, and over time, it's been shown that that can help redevelop the speech. So they're using that singing song intonation. You might remember it was often used as a treatment for stuttering as well. The sing song intonation would be a way of getting past that stopping and starting. It gave flow. Same is true in Parkinson's disease. Music is used as a way to improve flow, to stop that freezing gait where it's hard to take that first step. The music, the rhythm of the music can entrain the limbs. Same way you tap your foot when you hear the music, it's using that same principle, and it helps people to move. And it helps people to move smoothly so they can imagine the music and move or have it in their, some sort of sound device so that they can hear the music. And social connectedness is always a huge thing, particularly as people age. They may become more isolated in their communities. Music is a way of bringing people together. And as I say, that incentive is really important. Music has so many benefits all across the lifespan, from the cradle right to the very end of life. Music can always affect our health and well-being, but we don't give it the value that it needs. It should be a public health priority, that music is absolutely embedded in the curriculum for children. It's not an extracurricular activity. It is core. Every child needs to learn to sing. Every child needs the opportunity to play an instrument. It's not an optional extra.
Thank you, Anne-Marie. I'm not sure I can follow that with as much emotion and joy, but I'll try my best. So good evening, Yapulingina, everyone in the room and those online. Thanks for coming along this evening. And I'd just like to spend a bit of time now while we're together thinking about what's happening in the brain when we respond to music. And I'll start off as a neuroscientist, I'll start off with a few brain basics. Let's see. So the human brain weighs about 1.5 kilograms and it comprises about 86 billion neurons. The principal cell type of the brain is the neuron, and neurons come in all shapes and sizes, but essentially they're really highly branched cells. As you can see up here in the top corner, there's a range of different neurons there. They can project over short distances or very long distances. The longest one in the brain would probably start up at the top here and go all the way down to the bottom of your spinal cord, about in the middle of your back. So they can be very long cells, and they're very fragile cells. Now, neurons are electrically active and they communicate with each other by transferring pulses of electricity. Waves of electricity go from one neuron to the next. And where that electricity goes from one cell to another is at a structure called the synapse, which you can see up here in blue. And essentially the two neurons come together, but they don't quite touch. There's a little gap in between. And when the electricity comes down the first neuron, little packets of chemicals called neurotransmitters are released across that gap, and then they get detected by a range of different receptors and channels in the neighbouring neuron, who convert that energy back into electricity, and then off the signal goes again down to the next neuron. Now, most of the neurons are born very early in life, in the first few months or years, and then they spend about 20 years developing really highly branched networks in the brain. And over the lifespan, there's a little bit, but not very much, in the way of ongoing addition of new neurons to the circuits. But we do know that the brain circuits can change across the lifespan. And most of that change in connectivity happens at the level of the synapse here. And at the simplest level, synapses can disappear, new ones can form, and we can also have the synapses changing in size or strength. And all of those things together with the arsenal of different neurotransmitters and channels and receptors at the synapse, mean that the brain is able to respond and continually remodel throughout life. Now, it's not just one neuron to the next, which controls human behaviour. Neurons tend to stick together in groups, they're functionally related groups, and over a period of time we have managed to define which parts of the brain have which kinds of different functions. And some of them you can see there in the human brain over in the bottom corner. In the frontal parts of the brain, in the red section, is where we have all our higher order planning, executive function, problem solving, as well as things like speech and motor control. At the back of the brain, we have things like visual processing. Out on the sides in the temporal lobes, that's where our learning and memory centres are. And then down in the bottom of the brain, in the grey section there, that's where things like heart rate and breathing rate are controlled. So with that in mind, which parts of the brain are active when we hear music? So from a brain circuitry point of view, it's pretty straightforward in that music comes in as sound waves in through the ears. The sound comes through the auditory canal, and then the sound waves become pressure waves, and they move through a series of fluid-filled chambers and little oscillating bones, and then they reach this sort of circular structure called the cochlea, which is fluid-filled again, and all the way up the walls of that, the one that looks a bit like a shell, there are little hair cells that are neurons, and the hair cells get deflected by different pressure waves. And those deflections in the hair cells get turned into electricity that travels through the pathways that you see in the central image there, going up through the brainstem and out to this part of the brain in the temporal cortex called the primary auditory cortex, which you can see in that sort of pinky rose colour just there. So when it comes to music, from the point of view of music, you can break it down into different components. There are things like melody, harmony, and rhythm, and they all have their own circuitry, but largely overlapping in these pathways from what you can see here. And we know the most about rhythm, or I know the most about rhythm, so I'll try and explain it to you. And we found out about this using neuroimaging experiments to shed light on which parts of the brain are active when we hear a rhythm. And so in this first case study that I'd like to describe to you, healthy adults were positioned into an MRI, a magnetic resonance imaging machine, where we can look for different activation patterns in the brain. And while these healthy adults were in the MRI, they were exposed to a rhythm, like a continuous beat. And what we saw, or what we see, is that the pink areas there, the auditory cortex and the motor cortex, gets activated in response to the rhythm. And if you change the rhythm to make it accented, the same areas are activated. And then if you stop the rhythm and you ask the person to imagine the rhythm, the same parts of the brain are activated. And then just to make sure that they're imagining the correct rhythm, you can ask them to tap it out with their finger in the machine. And again, it's the same regions. It's the auditory cortex there in the temporal lobe and the motor regions in blue that you can see there at the back of the frontal lobe. And this is the same in lots of different people. We always see the same activation patterns. And you might have experienced yourself this co-activation of these two areas when you hear music that really makes you want to move, and you can't help but to move and to dance or tap your feet, move your bodies as the choir were doing earlier. And that's an example of where you yourself would have experienced this co-activation of the auditory and the motor regions. And in the clinical setting, this can be harnessed for people with Parkinson's disease. Now, Parkinson's disease is associated with loss of internal cues for timing and movement, And there's a global phenomenon right now called Dance for Parkinson's, where you invite people with Parkinson's to come along to dance classes, and over a period of weeks, as they're learning how to dance or remembering how to dance, their Parkinsonian symptoms decrease, and it's really beneficial for their movement and their gait. So we've talked about the auditory and the motor regions in the brain. What about the feel-good effect of music? Where does this live in the brain? So the pleasure-seeking or the reward centres rely heavily on a neurotransmitter called dopamine, and there are not very many cells that produce dopamine, but the ones that we have are down in the brainstem at the bottom of the brain, and these neurons have projections that go across many regions of the brain, and many of those networks you can see here in what we call the dopamine reward pathways. They project out to the frontal areas and some of the central parts of the brain, and they're really important in changing our mood. They make us feel good, and they're also important in our motor control areas. And they can, in addition to changing our mood, they're important in reward, addiction, and memory pathways. And I'll talk a bit more about memory soon. But neuroimaging studies have shown us that when we listen to music, we get activation of these dopamine reward pathways in all of the areas that you see highlighted there. And we know that the level of activation increases with the level of pleasure, or the more you like the music. So the more likeable the music is, the more activation you're getting in your dopamine reward pathways. And the underlying mechanism of this, of tapping into the dopaminergic reward system, might explain why we see all these improvements in mood, reduction in anxiety, enhanced well-being, and then in the clinical setting, music can be really good, as Anne-Marie's just told us, in psychiatric issues, depression, stroke, heart disease, and dementia. So listening to music activates your reward circuitry. So next time you can thank your dopamine-producing neurons when you feel that nice buzz listening to music. And if you like the music you hear, you'll get the buzz. If you don't like it, you don't have to worry about this reward circuitry, so it won't be firing. So how does music therapy work then? Well, there's a number of different theories around how music therapy works, and one of them taps into this circuitry that I've just described to you. And you have to remember that the goal of music therapy is not to learn a musical instrument or not to learn how to sing, but it's to learn to do something else. And so the theory goes that when you listen to music that's carefully chosen by a music therapist that's appropriate for the person and their condition or their context, you can flood the brain with dopamine and enhance the mood. And importantly, with all of this dopamine, especially going into the learning and memory centres, you can prime the brain for neuroplasticity to take place. And so music really gets the reward system firing, it floods the brain with dopamine, and then it's easier to learn another task. And then over time, with practice, you can stop playing the music and working with the music, and because you've been exercising that new circuitry for a new task that you might be learning for the first time or that you might be trying to restore, if you've had a stroke, for example, or after an injury, you can start to do those tasks much more easily, even in the absence of music, because you've been practicing and building up the strength of those connections. So music therapy can be much more than that. It can be in the individual situation, or it can be in groups, it can be listening to music, it can be playing, learning an instrument, singing, dancing, even composing music. And when you start, when you're in a group in particular, all these other functions and brain functions will be activated, some of which we've experienced tonight. And so you can see that it's not just the auditory and the motor parts of the brain that are getting activated when we experience, you know, the different types of music. So really it's a whole brain workout when you're experiencing and responding to music. So I'd like to talk a little bit now about dementia, which is one of the biggest neurodegenerative challenges facing us at the moment. It's the second leading cause of death in Australia, and it's the leading cause of death for women. There's lots of women in the audience, so listen up. We have an estimated 421,000 people in Australia with dementia, and that number's expected to double by about 2050. So it's a big issue for us, and soon it will be the leading cause of death for all Australians. Now, dementia comes in different types. There's many different sorts of dementia, but together, you get cognitive decline, the cognition starts working properly, it's always progressive, it goes in the same direction, and we can't stop it. And the most common type of dementia is Alzheimer's disease, which gives us changes in memory, thinking and behaviour. And similar to other dementias, but in Alzheimer's disease, there are two main things that are going on in the brain. We've got a sticky protein that builds up called amyloid. It's what looks like the brown piece of popcorn over there. Interrupts the circuitry. And the other thing we see is that the neurons themselves, the structural elements, one of them called tau, starts to tangle up, which means that the neurons can't work properly and they pull back all of those synapses and connections. And together you get what's called atrophy or shrinkage of the brain, which results in loss of function. It doesn't happen everywhere, and it certainly, it starts in the temporal lobes, which is the areas that are involved in learning and memory, and that's why we see problems with memory in Alzheimer's type dementia as one of the first signs. So as it happens, the auditory regions of the brain are relatively spared in Alzheimer's type dementia, and so I'm going to talk you through this, what looks quite complex. Hopefully I can explain it for you. It's another MRI study, and if you just focus on the images at the top there, we've got healthy adults listening to music, and they've played three different types of music. Music that they've known for a long period of time, music that they've recently heard, and music that they've never heard before. And if you move between these three different types of music and you look at the activation patterns in the brain, there's one part of the brain that's active only when you hear music that you've learned a long time ago. And in this case, the authors called it the long-term music memory centre. I mean, it doesn't matter what you call it, but it's that red piece of the brain up there is the part that gets activated when you're listening to that music that you've heard from a long time ago that Anne-Marie was also talking about. And if you have a look now in the bottom images, these are brains of people with Alzheimer's disease. And the details are unimportant, but where you see more colour is where you have more disease. And so in the bottom panel, we're looking at the amyloid, we're looking at that sticky protein that builds up, and you'll notice that in the area for long-term music memory, there's not very much colour because that part's relatively spared. And if you look in the grey matter atrophy in the middle, that's the shrinkage of the brain, you get most of it happening on the sides, so you can see where it's brightly coloured there. But in the area that's involved in long-term music memory, it's still intact, which might explain some of the things that Anne-Marie was talking about, and also what I'm about to show you in this little video here. Now, this is a video that comes from the Alzheimer's Research Association. It's a Spanish lady by the name of Marta, and she was a professional ballerina earlier in her life, and she's now living with advanced Alzheimer's disease. Have a look at what happens to her when she responds to hearing Tchaikovsky's Swan Lake. And I'll move to somewhere a little bit closer to home now. And with permission, I'd like to share a video that comes from a Tasmanian family. The man that you see here is being cared for by his daughter in Oatlands, or near to Oatlands. And he has had a lifelong love of music. And even now, in his later stages of dementia, he responds extremely well to music. And his daughter has even started up a community choir in Oatlands. It's the Currawong Community Choir. It meets on Sunday mornings. And she did this to give them an opportunity to be able to experience music and the joy of singing together. And I'd like to play you a little movie of her and her father singing together.
Okay, so a little song. Okay. One, two, three. Tiny kangaroo
down spot. Tiny
kangaroo
down.
Tiny kangaroo down. Tiny kangaroo down. Tiny kangaroo down. Tiny kangaroo down. Tiny kangaroo down. Tiny kangaroo down. Yay!
Hooray! 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 And this is lovely.
Oh, that's nice.
So So you really can, you know, feel that joy that they're experiencing. And you notice he didn't remember all the words, but he remembered the tune and the, you know, the emotion was there for them both. Now, dementia, you know, we've talked a bit about it this evening. This is sort of towards the later stages of dementia. But dementia starts much earlier in life, we know now, and the research happening in the dementia area at the moment is still focused on looking for a cure for this disease, but we're also starting to look now to find out what it is that might be causing dementia to start. In the absence of a cure, what can we do, and what kind of public health approach or prevention approach could we take for dementia, given its scale in the world at the moment? And in 2017, a medical journal, The Lancet, commissioned a team of people to really look at the evidence for what kind of evidence there would be for preventing dementia from starting in the first place. And we've now, a subsequent study released in 2020 by the same team has identified 12 risk factors for dementia. And we've realised that if we account for all of these risk factors, if we could eliminate them all, we would prevent about 40% of dementias occurring at a population level. Now, 40% is a lot. That would be 168,000 Australians who are living with dementia today that might not have it if they could have prevented that disease. It's a, you know, it's a big number, and if you have a look at some of the risk factors that we've identified for dementia, you'll see that whilst we know the biggest risk factor is age, the older you get, the more likely you are to get dementia. We know there's a genetic component, but we think 40% of cases could be due to some of these risk factors that you see here. And the good news is that these risk factors are things that we can address in midlife and later life. So if you have a look at the diagram over on the right there, the grey line sort of represents the lifespan. At the beginning of life, we know that the number of years of education you get is very important. And in midlife, we get clusters of things like hearing impairment, traumatic brain injury, high blood pressure, excessive alcohol consumption and obesity becoming risk factors. About 15% of dementias could be prevented by midlife changes. And then you see some of these other smoking, depression, low social contact, physical inactivity, air pollution and diabetes all being important in later life. And there's some other emerging risk factors on the horizon, but these are the ones we have at the moment. Now, the good news is we can do something about this. It's to really look at midlife and later life. And this is the case of dementia. Other neurological diseases are similar. We're starting to understand, you know, modifiable lifestyle factors. Some of these will cluster around medical management, but others cluster around, you know, how we choose to live our lives. And in 2022, the World Health Organization released a position paper around brain health, and they defined this new concept of brain health being the state of brain functioning across cognitive, sensory, socio-emotional, behavioural and motor domains, allowing a person to realise their full potential, irrespective of the presence or absence of disease. So the message is the same for all of us. It's midlife, it's late life, it's early life. It doesn't matter if you have a disease or not. There are lots of things that we can do to look after our brain health. And when it comes to brain health, I thought we could use our choir as an example. You know, they are certainly looking after their brain health. If we bring this back to music, they're staying physically active, they're getting out and about, they're standing up, they're exercising all of their core muscles as they sing. They're looking after their heart at the same time with that control of their breathing and the exercise. They're staying socially engaged. They're out and about regularly interacting with each other and connecting with each other. And they're certainly exercising their brain, as we've seen earlier today, singing not only in English but in, I think, other languages and learning new songs. And, you know, perhaps they'll go out for a meal or something together tonight. So the evidence is in the room, and not drink too much alcohol. So the evidence is in the room for us. You know, we've experienced it, we've heard the choir sing, and I think now is our opportunity to not only hear the choir sing again, but for all of us to actively engage and to feel what it looks, what it feels like to actually sing along with the choir. So with that, I'd like to leave you with brain health. Everyone, now, it's never too late. Thanks.
So we're going to learn a little bit of Fix You, the song we played earlier. What I'll do is we'll have the choir sing it, and I'll sing it. So just first of all, listen, absorb, and then we'll work on it. So we go 1, 2, 3. I love the nods. It's like, we're ready. Come on, let's go. So it's going to be let's just do that. Ready? That's half of it. Awesome. Now option. Yeah, they're going to go How's that note? Let's do it. Ready? Legends. Okay. Oh, let's have you, little wedgie. My little wedge here, my wedge-tailed eagles. We're going to be doing the alto part of the melody. You're ready. I can see by your face, you're just like, is that it? Sure, let's go. Here we go. Should we try these two together? Yes, let's do it. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Show you. Now you're going to hold this first note for 8. Okay, so just brace yourself through. 1, 2, 3. You got that, fellas? Yeah, great, let's try. Four times. Magical. Let's try it all together. So we're Yes. You sounded like a real choir just then. Okay, 1, 2, 3, and bit of the chorus. Let's do the melody. That's you guys. Ready? So,
lights.
Here we go.
Lights will guide you home. I will try.
I'll allow it. You can sing that first one. Lives will guide you home. Second one. And ignite your bones. Just that. And ignite your bones. Let's put those two together. So, lights will guide.
Lights will guide you home.
We're going to jump up.
And ignite your bones.
So good.
And I will try.
Okay, trick. Tricky bit. Men, you're going to do okay, I promise.
And I will try.
Yeah. I love your confident faces. Let's do this. So I was going to go.
I will try.
One more.
And I will try. To fix you.
Right. So we're going to sing with this middle part.
Lights will guide you home and ignite your bones. And I will try to fix you.
We can go through that whole thing. Here we go. Thank you, online people. I hope you're singing along as well. So let's do ours and fix you and give it your best, which in my work and world, don't try for 100% ever. Best is not 100%. Best is just like, this feels so great. I'm awesome. Okay. So wherever that level is for you, we all have different levels of that. Mine's about 70%. So here we go. We're going to start with ours. Yes. Forgetting my arrangement. Okay, here we go. 1, 2, 3, and. You're a great choir.
I think we should all do that again at some point. That was absolutely magnificent. There are already a lot of choirs in Hobart, but I think we've just formed a new one. I think that needs a renewed performance at some point. Naresh, thank you very much, Betsy. That was magnificent once again. It's time now to do our second pulse check, now that we've had a sing. So I'll invite you to bring out your mobile phones one more time, which hopefully are still on, of course. And you'll find a second QR code up on the screen and follow the prompts as you did before. Now, while you're all doing that, a couple of words from me. Shortly, once all the results are in, we'll have a tabulation, and up on the screen we'll see the results of our pulse checks before we did the singing and then subsequently after. And there we have the results. I think that shows a clear improving in the mood in the room. And I think we have Betsy's marvellous leadership to thank us for that. That was one wonderful job you've done there, Betsy. I think at this point, I'm going to invite our panellists to head over to the benches over there. I'm also going to invite, as you can see there, Madelena Anderson-Ward to join the panel. We heard Maddie's marvellous singing as an introduction to our event this evening. A few words about Maddie before we move to a Q&A. Maddie is a local indie pop singer and songwriter and is a graduate of the Utah's Conservatorium of Music. In 2018, Maddie won the Tasmanian Indigenous Young Achievers Award in recognition of her tutoring support of young musicians privately and through the Indigenous Tutorial Assistance Scheme. The award also recognises Maddie starting her own business and her musical achievements and performances, including a mezzo-soprano role in a Tasmanian Requiem. Maddie now works in Utah's Riawunna Centre for Education. So thank you very much, Maddie, not only for joining the panel. Alison, I might give you the first question from me. Can you comment on what we've seen in a measurable lift in mood in the room this evening?
From what I saw where I was sitting, I could see an improvement of the mood, significant improvement in rating of well-being, moving up to the 8s and 10s, which is fabulous. I did notice a few people had voted quite low down and some of them had appeared right down at the bottom of the list. I wondered if they were the people that were very anxious or frightened about singing or were needing to leave or use the bathroom or were put off by those out of tune singing next to them. I'm sorry if that was me. But I think generally what we did see was some evidence perhaps of that dopamine reward circuitry, you know, the feel-good effects of participating in music, listening. We had a beautiful display of Madeline earlier singing as we came in, and then the choir again, and when we all got to really participate in that, it does give you a big uplift. And we've talked, Anne-Marie talked about that, and I talked about it too, you know, working in groups and that sort of social connection really does activate parts of your brain that probably don't get enough activation when we're sitting still. And on top of that, you know, we had the extra exercise and the blood flow and the oxygen going into the brain, having a bit of a move around after the session of sitting and listening. So I think that's probably what was happening to us, with some movement up and some down for some members of the audience.
Awesome. Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to do my best to alternate between questions here in the room and I'm already a huge number of questions that have come in online, which is wonderful to see. I'm going to start with a question online. This is from Paul. And Anne-Marie, I think this might be one that you might have something to say about. Paul asks, why is it that despite the health value of singing, there's a significant underrepresentation of men in community singing?
Yes. Great question, Paul. Thank you for asking. I think it's not an international phenomenon. So if you look in choirs in other countries, often they have no shortage of men. They have men's choirs as well. In Australia, we seem to have had a problem that occurred sometime during the 20th century where young men felt it was inappropriate to sing in a choir and it contradicted their masculinity. This is an issue that has been addressed in some schools by saying you can't be in the first 11 and you can't be in the rugby team and you can't be in the AFL team unless you also sing in the choir.
Thank you very much, Anne-Marie. Do we have any questions in the room? All yours.
Thank you. I'll just address the question to Associate Professor Canty. In some of your prevention, you described early midlife and later life. I'll get you to just to quantify those age groups. And also, what is a healthy heart diet, please?
Sure, they're both really good questions. In terms of the evidence that we're seeing that's telling us, you know, clustering these modifiable risk factors around midlife and late life, One of the big problems that we have is every study is done differently. And so I can't tell you that midlife is, you know, 47 to 62, but most studies would look from, you know, 40s to 60s as being midlife, and then later life is sort of mid-60s, 70s plus in terms of general age groups. And what is a healthy diet? A healthy heart diet or a brain healthy diet? The evidence that we're seeing now, another thing that's quite difficult to quantify, because usually when you ask people about their diet, you're asking about what they've done in the past and how they've eaten, you know, over many decades perhaps, or many years, and it's really difficult to remember. But so it's hard to quantify exactly, you know, what you need to eat every day. But what we do know is that the Mediterranean diet is one of the better diets for brain health. It's really rich in fish oils, the omega-3 oils, nuts and seeds, lots of fresh vegetables, olive oils, and not so much in the way of red saturated fats and red meat. So if you're interested in what kind of foods, look up the Mediterranean diet or the MIND diet, are both ones that we have some good evidence for now. But the evidence when it comes to individual supplements is not as strong. What we're starting to understand is that it's an overarching diet and it's a holistic diet that we need to look after our brain health.
Thank you very much. And I will note that there were several questions along the same lines about the brain health diet online as well. So thank you very much. It's a very pertinent question, clearly. I've got another question online, which I think Betsy might be able to help us out with. It's an anonymous question, but what if I was tone deaf? I may still benefit from singing loudly, but wouldn't it bring distress to the people around me?
It's so funny how people have this version of tone deaf. Like it's kind of rare as far as, like, in, I've been doing choirs for about 25 years, and honestly, probably only two people in that time, I've kind of gone, you're really not getting it, like, not at all. And and actually, once I said, maybe just sing a little quieter, and not to shut him down, because he was such a fantastic and enthusiastic person, I said, because I think by singing so loud, you're not actually hearing what's going on around you. And once he did that, he actually was able to find pitch and go, oh. A little self-reflection, and actually was able to alter. So I don't know statistically, you know, if the proportion of people that might not be able to pitch. And I think that's what people mean when they say I'm tone deaf, because they, but a lot of, you know, in our sort of Western culture, we have such a sort of competitive thing around music and singing and the arts in general, that, you know, you've got your winners and your losers. And I think for me, particularly, I think choir singing is just such a great place to be an amateur. You don't have to be fantastic. You don't have to be the best. You can really be just right, just good enough. And actually, it's this blend that happens, which creates this real magic. So I kind of go along those lines that, you know, just about everybody can sing. And it just a little bit of practice and a little bit of, you know, listening, yeah, and learning and being willing to have a go actually improves people's voices, you know, a lot. So don't worry about anybody else. Get in that car, sing really loud, and start practicing in your car, and then join a choir.
What an excellent answer.
Firstly, thank you, Betsy, for not naming Don and I in that last one. My question goes to the middle age grouping of factors in dementia, and the hearing loss was by far the biggest at 8%. Is there an understanding of why that is?
We're not exactly sure at the moment. The evidence, we have the evidence that hearing loss is a risk factor. We don't know whether, and it could be both, it could be what we call a prodromal part of the disease, which is an early sign of the disease before you get the overt symptoms, sort of like the memory or cognition symptoms. But it could also be completely separate to the disease, happening much earlier. And if anyone has had hearing loss and you notice that you might withdraw a little bit, you might stop going out, you might stop meeting with your friends, You might stop going to classes because you can't hear, and so then all of your other risk factors start to creep up a little bit because you're not being able to engage in the same way as you could because you can't hear anymore. But the good news about hearing loss is that if you get your hearing loss corrected, and if you need, go and get your hearing tested, would be my advice if you're worried, and fit your hearing aids if you need them, and then use them, and then your risk will be much lower. So you can actually modify that risk. It's probably one of the easiest to modify just by getting your hearing tested and getting hearing aids fitted correctly compared to some of those other risks. It's an easy win, and it's one that not many people know about. And it, up on the figure that I showed you, it's about 8% of dementias. It's a lot of dementias that we think are caused by hearing loss. Now, some of the evidence is hard to tease out because we have to find out how long the hearing loss occurs for before the disease, and there might be some overlap. So that's what we're still working on. But get your hearing tested, wear your hearing aids, and you'll reduce your risk.
I've got another question online here. This comes from Jude, and Maddie, I'm wondering if you might be able to help us out here. I'm thinking here particularly of your experience tutoring other musicians and starting your own business and performing as a musician professionally. Now, Jude, I'll give you a bit of background here. Jude speaks of having suffered from periods of depression and comments that, I'm not quite scroll far on, oh no, I have it here, that the fortnightly or monthly music lesson was a joy of Jude's life, month, and to provide purpose and lifting depression for at least today, which is wonderful to hear. Jude's question comes to, is there any way that we can prompt government or health services to consider more active funding of the ability to take music lessons or free transport to participate in choirs, that kind of support for music in the community? Is there anything from your experience that you could contribute to that, do you think?
Yeah, I think this comes back to our professors who are presenting tonight. There needs to be more recognition in general of the power of music and the importance to our health and well-being and the necessity for us for our well-being. When we had the image of the brain and the sections that were lighting up or not lighting up, and we had our ballerina, all I could think of was song lines and Indigenous cultures and knowledges. For millennia, people have learnt important information through melodies and songs and actions and dance, and then tied that those stories deeply into the landscape that they're living in. That's how we've survived. And all of those songs are really important for, like, holding important information. They are the encyclopedias. They are our Indigenous knowledges, and that is what we all need to connect with more. And this I don't know if you call it an epidemic of dementia, is showing we're not using enough of our brains. Our societies have become very reserved, and if you do the use it or lose it mentality, we need to be creative, we need to give ourselves permission, we need to support all ages within our societies to express themselves, connect with music, move. We're very reserved, and it's showing because we're shutting down. We're literally shutting down parts of our brain, and we all lose out from that happening. So, yeah, it's important. We need more recognition of the power of music. It's not an add-on. It's not an other. It's not an indulgence. It is essential to our being. If we watch babies singing and playing or responding to music, we should be masters of that as adults. It's not something that we should be stopping.
Hear, hear. I think we have another question in the room.
Yeah. My question goes to Anne-Marie. Yeah. So I'm just wondering if the music already in the first line of the treatment for for dementia, and if not, how practical it is to add it into the first line treatment, and also if we want it to be the first line treatment for dementia, is like a random singing or listening helps, or we need scientific designed music therapy?
There have already been quite a lot of scientific studies about the way in which music works for people with dementia. There's been a lot of work done on listening, so creating playlists of music that people enjoyed when they were younger and using those playlists, but they find that they reduce agitation and also often awaken them, you know, and bring up memories. And for people who are non-verbal or non-responsive, it will actually make them much more responsive. To be at the point where we start prescribing music, using arts on prescription, as they do in the UK, we need to be able to call on that evidence. But the evidence is already in. This is the problem. The evidence is already in. We just need to find the ways of getting the music to the people and the people to the music.
Thank you, Anne-Marie. I'm going to allow one more question. I'm looking and conscious of the time. We just ticked over 8 o'clock, but I have one more question that I saw pop up online here. And Alison, I'm going to throw this one in your direction. It comes from an anonymous online guest at the event who is typing on behalf of their son, who is 11 years old and listening. And the question is, the question is, how can music help people with ADHD and autism?
Oh, that's a tough one. I wonder, Anne-Marie, if you can draw on some of your experiences working with children and teenagers.
I mean, children with autism often have a very strong attraction to music, and therefore it may be a way in for them to learn social activities. So if they're learning a musical instrument and going to play in an orchestra, they're mixing with other people, they're learning social skills through that way. The way in which the music works within their brains can also increase their ability to learn. So that flood of
dopamine,
yep. Yeah, I was going to say, and serotonin, yeah. Will allow them to prime the learning pathways to learn other skills that they may need to learn. So, in a way, music can encourage that learning process on a whole range of skills. And for children with autism, it can also help their social development, behavioural things. It can reduce what they call stimming, those movements that are part of the self-soothing. The music can help find new ways to self-soothe.
I'll just add to that, just because I've had an experience actually today with a young autistic student who has been very disengaged, and we've just been doing a lot of sort of playing and a bit of fun. And today I just said, do you want to come do some music? We've been doing a few musical instrument things, and he said yes. came in and I just played the piano. I was doing that echoing and mirroring, and after a little while I said, do you want to sing a song? I'd like to hear you sing. And he made up a whole song story and had this most beautiful melodic voice and just sang very sweetly. The content of the song was interesting. very sweet and interesting content. The psychologist was going, that's interesting. But, I've just had that experience today of working with this person and who left just smiling and calm and so regulated. I just wanted to add that in because I've had that actual experience today with someone who's autistic.
Thank you all very, very much indeed. I think when I look at the time, that very sadly we have now run out of time for further questions either from the room or online. So I think at this stage in the evening, I think it's time to thank our panellists. We have Associate Professor Anne-Marie Forbes, Associate Professor Alison Canty, Madelena Andersen-Ward, and of course, Betsy Hansen and the wonderful Nourish Women's Choir. Thank you all for taking part in this special event, because you all have taken part and it's been most wonderful. My final words then on behalf of the University of Tasmania and the Festival of Voices. Thank you for coming. Please do have a happy and safe evening. Good night to you all.